Hey, hey, welcome to the Summit Host Hangout Podcast, where you'll learn how to plan, strategize, and launch your profitable online summit. No influencer status necessary. I'm your host, Krista from Summit in a Box, and today in episode 75, I have a guest I can't wait for you to hear from and a topic I cannot wait for you to hear about, and that topic is increasing the profits from your virtual summit with a funnel. And this is actually a really big topic, both for summit hosts and speakers. So we're going to hit on both sides of that today, because it's so important to me that you are getting the most out of every single summit you run and every summit that you put effort into speaking at and promoting. To give you some background information on our guest, she helps business owners fall in love with and make money from simple and sleaze-free summits. I am all about that. She's created three multiple six-figure businesses of her own and has helped her clients create millions of dollars for themselves through funnels. So I'm excited to hear how she sees us fitting funnels into our overall summit strategy to make an even bigger impact for our businesses. So without further ado, let's dive in and talk with Kate McKibbon. Welcome, Kate. Thank you so much for being here.
Oh, thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited to nerd out with you today.
Oh my gosh, I am so pumped to do some nerding out about summits and funnels. This is like a dream come true, right? Before we dive into that, tell us a little bit about your business.
Yeah, so my business, I'm currently going through a rebrand. So let's just say name TBC. But basically, I'm a bit of a nerd. I love funnels. I originally started out as a quote-unquote fashion blogger back in 2007, before I knew what blogging was. And I built up a big audience, and I had this kind of whole publishing model thing happening. And everyone's like, oh my gosh, you've created this thing. It's so amazing. You must be so successful and rich. And I'm like, no money coming from that at all. It was enough to pay the bills, but I'm pretty sure I could have earned more working at McDonald's. And so then I started getting really interested in going, okay, well, how can you get monetized audiences? Like, how can you sort of, you know, make things that aren't going to be reliant on ad dollars and, you know, fluctuations in markets and all that kind of stuff. So that's when I started really getting into setting up funnels. Although, again, I didn't really realize what it was that didn't have that name at the time. And long story short, that's kind of been my obsession ever since. And over the years, I've definitely, you know, I've tried them all. I've tested absolutely every shiny marketing tactic there is out there. And I've found a couple that just work, you know, really, really well, sort of day in, day out, different niches, that kind of thing. And that's what I now love helping other business owners do, because it's kind of like creating this little engine that sits in the back of your business that just, you know, means you have this level of reliability, this ability to go, okay, start of the month, I know I'm going to roughly get this amount of sales, whether I'm launching or not. That's going to cover my bills, going to keep the lights on. And then you can kind of, you can launch if you want, you can do affiliates if you want, you can do all that stuff. But you just have that level of certainty, which I think just makes business feel so much easier and a lot less stressful. And that's kind of, yeah, that's my jam. That's what I like helping people with.
Yeah. It's so cool hearing you talk about this, because actually, within the last 30, 45 days, this is the first time where I have had a really solid funnel that I can count on. And in the past, I've been like, oh, my services are booked out for a few months. Like, you know, that makes me feel comfortable. Oh no, this is awesome. Knowing that I can expect a sale of a certain amount on a daily basis or twice a day. Like, oh my gosh, it is life-changing. Like literally, I know that sounds so cheesy, but I love that that's kind of how you explained it, because I didn't know it was possible until it happened, really.
And it's just this like weight that comes off your shoulders. And I love that moment. I see it with my clients when they go, oh, it can be like this. Like this is, you know, like it didn't ever really occur, I think, to so people. We just get so used to, you have to hustle, you have to run like really, really hard and fast, and it's never going to be certain or stable. And that's just business. And there's always going to be, obviously, you know, things happen and whatnot. But, you know, with like right now in the world, things are very uncertain and unstable. And my clients are going, yeah, we're still good. We're still okay. Like, you know, and I think that's like, it's a gift to have that sort of, you know, take away that stress. So that's what I love to do. And yeah, it's when you experience it, it probably just sounds like we're, you know, all marketing BS when you sort of haven't haven't experienced it, but when you have, you just go, wow.
Yeah, I'm one of those people now.
You're a convert.
Yeah. Okay, so a lot of people that I talk to, and like I've been guilty of this for my first three summits, I thought this way. But we look at summits as their own standalone way to make money and get visible because they can be so profitable and so powerful, but really there is a huge opportunity to use them to lead into other offers, to fuel our funnels, maybe to be a part of our funnel, other than the entry point. Would you say that people who don't look at a summit as part of their overall funnel are leaving money on the table?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I've only had done one summit myself, which I did last year. And that was kind of a, let's see what happens kind of thing. But I already had my funnel set up. So I was looking at it more of as an experiment of like, oh, I wonder if people from here would convert well over here. And I was blown away, because I think when you create this summit, you're attracting super, like, as your people would know, you're attracting like super targeted people. You've spent this time creating this great relationship, this great trust with them. And then obviously, like, I'm not sure the exact setup that you teach as far as how people set up their actual summits and promotions and selling and whatnot in there, but just because the summit ends, like, it doesn't mean that these people all of a sudden are no longer interested or they're no longer still needing help. And one of the things that I think is so great when you have a funnel is that it caters for the fact that some people are ready to go right now. Some people need a couple of weeks. Some people, you know, maybe they just paid off their car or bought a holiday and they're like, oh, I wish I could have done this, but it's not the right time. So, you know, having a funnel or that next sort of longer process in place is absolutely, if you don't have that, it's leaving money on the table because you're not giving people that opportunity to purchase at that time that maybe suits them better than the time that you kind of said, you know, doors are open, doors are closed kind of thing.
Yeah, that's such a good point. I think maybe a lot of people maybe don't look at it that way as an overall overarching plan because they're like, I just, you know, hit people with the summit. I've been in their inbox constantly. I need to wait. But it's like you said, they might need something from you right now. Like that's why they signed up for your summit in the first place. So that's a really great point.
Yeah. And I think that particularly, like, I know when you're creating a summit, like it feels like it's a lot, you know, you've done a lot of work and you've been in there and you've hustled and you're probably like, I don't want to have to do another thing. But the beauty of creating a funnel is another thing you got to create. But once you've created it, every time you run a summit or any time you are on a summit, maybe, or whatever, you know, you can then be pointing people into this thing and it just works. Like it's the ultimate, like, create the asset, let it keep paying for itself for years to come. You know, you don't want to add an extra thing to people's plates when they're already sort of feeling a bit overwhelmed or burnt out. But if it's a thing that you can schedule like a week or so to set up, it will definitely pay off over time.
I totally, totally agree with that. Sometimes it's worth adding extra to our to-do list if we do it the right way.
Yes.
So talk us through a great way to use a funnel to increase profits as a summit host. And kind of like you hinted at before, there's lots of different ways you could make this work. But like if you had to key on one, what would that look like?
So my favorite type of funnel is a webinar funnel. Just because I feel like it gives, you know, well, apart from the fact that the statistics that it's been proven to be one of the best converting tactics for evergreen ever, but it allows you to connect, to communicate your message, to really showcase what your offer is, to take people on that journey that you need to take for them to go through the, you know, acknowledge that they haven't a problem, show them some solutions, gain some trust, you know, and make the offer. Like it's just, even though I'm one of those people who dreads having to do webinars, they are so powerful. I get over that and I do them anyway. But what I did myself with my summit, and I've seen people do this with challenges and with other things as well, is create a webinar that kind of is seen as helping people figure out their next steps or their, you know, to take action. Because anytime when they've gotten a whole lot of information, and they're probably feeling super inspired, but probably a little overwhelmed. And you want them to take some sort of action because that's how they're going to get some results and going to get really great value from what you've created anyway. And it becomes then not just this other like, oh, come and learn more stuff. It's like, okay, let's put a plan together or whatever. So if you can create a webinar that has that kind of premise, and then as part of that, you then say, you know, if you have an offer that kind of makes sense for to help people with that action plan or taking those next steps, then it's a really natural sort of thing. Like, it's not like trying to shoehorn something in here. It's like, let's help you make a plan. If you want some help with that plan, here's my offer. And, you know, so it's creating, yeah, a really simple sort of follow-up sequence of emails, inviting people to an evergreen webinar, which maybe you do it live the first time for your first one. And then you can just sort of invite people to the recording next time you run it. Yeah, it doesn't have to be anything too crazy. And then, you know, if that works really well and you kind of get the bug, well, then you can sort of have go, well, maybe then you have give a bit more value, just have a sequence of some of your best emails that are follow up, and maybe you have a little flash sale or something like 3 weeks later. Like, again, just to give people a couple of touch points. But I mean, personally, my funnel is 6 months long. I don't expect people to do that. It takes a while. But, you know, it's one of those things you kind of like add a little building block and then you add another little building block and, you know, as you go.
Dang, that's intense. Okay, so I took so many notes while you were going all that, going through all that. I love that you pointed us to a webinar, and we were talking beforehand and we were kind of like, you know, poking fun that so many people say webinars don't work, and we're both sitting here like, okay, guys. And like, I totally agree. I'm glad that's what you brought up here. Not only because they work, but also because I feel like you can fit it so naturally with what people were accustomed to during your summit. They were used to coming and watching presentations.
Yeah.
Your webinar fits in so well with that. That's like so perfect. Did you do your webinar as like a masterclass or something at the end of the summit, or did you do it after?
I did it after. So I gave people a little bit of a break, and it wasn't fully intentional. I was like 8 months pregnant at the time. So I gave myself a bit of a break as well. I was just like, I just got to be realistic with what I can do. So yeah, I gave them a little bit of a break, and but they knew it was there. It was like, okay, here's the summit, and then add this date as like a bonus, almost presented almost as like a bit of a, surprise and delight. Like, hey guys, I know you're going to be like super overwhelmed. I'm going to let it all sink in, and then we're going to get together and we're going to plan this out. So you've got an action step. I always try and find the win-win when it's really like, and Kate just needs to sleep for a couple of days in between.
That's impressive. It sounds like you nailed that. Oh my gosh. Could you give us an example, like maybe yours, like what your summit was about? And then you said you positioned your webinar to help people figure out the next step. So maybe like what your webinar overall topic was.
Yeah. So my summit, it was probably a bit broad. I was just going with easy. I was like, I've got friends and I'm going to ask them to all come on and we're going to chat. And this is like, so mine was just called the Doing It Online Summit. And I just interviewed friends who had online businesses about sort of different topics about how they got started and how they grew and different sort of marketing tactics they were using. So my webinar was create a 90-day marketing plan from what you've learned, like how to sort of figure out what the best tactics are going to be for you and to map out a plan that's going to work. And, you know, and through that, you know, obviously I talked about the people that, you know, the difference between having a plan and not having a plan and having help with that plan. And, you know, you sort of paint the picture, because, you know, so much of the stuff we were talking about was also related to obviously growing an audience and whatnot. And I talked very heavily about funnels. I was like, well, if one of the, you know, if part of your plan is setting up a funnel as it should be, then, you know, come along and I've got a funnel program. So that was sort of my little segue. It probably could have been nicer, but it was one of those things that as I was kind of making it up as I went along, I didn't have an awesome person like yourself to tell me what I was supposed to be doing.
Well, I mean, and you were on a time crunch too, from what it sounds like. So.
Yeah, I don't know why I sort of thought that, you know, I was like, oh, I'm going to have a baby in a couple of months. Let's do this really massive project.
I did the same thing. I had a baby and hosted my summit 3 months later. So I like was planning up until she was born, took a few months off. And then when she was 3 months old, the summit happened. So like bad decisions all around. We both survived. So
We did. And I think it was good. It was there's a
good distraction too. While you're waiting for a baby.
We're just sitting there like going, come on.
Yep. Oh my gosh. Okay, cool. Do you think there's like a certain price point people should go with for an offer coming right after a summit? Or do you think as long as it solves the problem, it's fine?
I mean, I feel there's a little bit of a sweet spot price point wise when you're going evergreen webinar. And it seems to be between like $500 and $1,000 is sort of like one of the highest converting. But that's not to say, like, I've seen people do amazing offers, really profitable, that are like $200 and also like $2,000. That's probably like your outside limits. But I always say people should lead with your most profitable product as well. So whatever, like, obviously it has to make sense for your summit as a next step. But if you've got a $1,000 course or a $27 membership, go with the $1,000, you know, start there, and you can always have a second offer you're a downsell or something like that to your lower priced offer, but always put your most profitable foot forward, because, you know, at the end of the day, we run businesses, not charities. And, you know, if you've got a great product, it gets great transformations, why wouldn't you, you know, sort of lead with that?
I love that. I'm all for that as well. Oh my goodness. Like, I'm excited. So I'm going to like focus on it right now so I can like, you know, do the thing with the webinar. I've never done a webinar to launch something right after a summit. And like, I can just see how powerful this is. People are warmed up, especially if you make your webinar really closely related to the summit and make it a next step, not just something where you're pitching, but something you're helping them, getting them a next step. But you know, the solution, the easy solution is your offer. Like, it's just natural. So I love that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Cool. So let's switch to the perspective of speaking at summits and seeing some revenue through that. And I've seen a lot of people speak at summits and pitch something paid at the end. It's not a strategy I have ever seen work well or heard anyone say that it works well. What are your thoughts on pitching something paid at the end of a summit presentation?
Yeah, no, I think it's quite a big ask. And I also think it's kind of slightly rude. It's kind of, you know, coming into the, you know, I know like some, obviously the summit host gets to decide whether or not they sort of let people do that. But I think pitching a great freebie and getting people onto your list, yes. Pitching a straight up paid product, I just don't think that they've probably, you know, even through your summit presentation and things like that, like it's meant to be training, it's meant to be value. You don't, there's a different formula for how you present information when it's a sales process versus when it's like just a value add. And yeah, I would be surprised if that worked very well for people. And I think people might find it jarring and then you might lose that trust that you've just kind of built. But when you have the, okay, well, come and get my freebie that is related to this topic, and then people are on your list, you sort of then have it the option to nurture them a bit to sort of, you know, because they don't, like as the speaker usually, you know, you've obviously acquired a bit of trust anyway, because you're associated with this, all the other speakers and in the summit, and you've just shared some great value. But I think he's probably still a little ways away from having the level of trust needed to go straight to here's an offer. And I think that's the, when it comes to having a funnel as well, you know, for after you've done something like this, whether it's be on a summit or even be on a podcast or something, like if people have, you know, people often, you know, have a like, hey, come check out my free thing for that too. You know, you want to definitely make sure that you are warming up people properly, that there's still steps that need to be taken. They still need more info on you. There's still trust that needs to be built a little bit there. And that was one thing I actually got as feedback from my summit, was that like everyone was going in and opting in for all these great freebies, and then people were getting pitched like straight away, or they were getting invited to a webinar like straight away or something like that. And they were, I had lots of my attendees come back and go, oh, next time you do this with all the other things, can we just have a break? Like, can you?
Oh gosh.
They're like, we want to do all the things. We want to go to all the stuff, but it's too much. So I think it probably would be valuable and almost like a sign of respect to the summit host as well, to like, you know, have your opt-in, have it set up, have one set up specifically for if you're doing summits or if you're doing podcasts or anything else like that. Have, you know, maybe a week or so of giving people content and value before you then start pitching to them, so they're not super overwhelmed, because you kind of have to be aware that they're in currently that, you know, if they're in a summit, they're getting lots of emails, they're getting lots of content, they don't have the brain space right this second to necessarily be taking on another thing. But you also don't want to then go, okay, well, I just won't communicate with you for a couple of weeks because I'll forget who you are. So I think just sort of being smart with what you sort of, how you sort of stay top of mind and how you keep giving them a little bit of value without overwhelming is probably, yeah, that'd be my best advice. And then you would invite them to whatever your highest converting thing is, whether again, whether it's a webinar, whether you have a flash sale, whether you have a challenge or whatever it is that you do as your preferred funnel. But I would just give people a little bit of time and space and just, you know, slowly add the value.
That's really cool that you said that. So I'm a part of a program where, you know, learning to set up an evergreen funnel. And what she recommends doing for summits is, you know, put your masterclass at the end or put your webinar at the end. And that's what I did for the last summit I was a part of. But now that you're talking through that, it's like, that is a lot. That's it's the week of a summit. How are they going to fit in my masterclass with all the summit presentations as well? And, you know, sure, the ones that are really excited, maybe they will. But those people are also the ones that would go to my website and find the masterclass or the webinar on my website and opt in there if they're ready for it. It's not going to hurt anything if I'm just letting it sit for a couple of weeks, giving them little pieces of value, and then going back in to get them to the webinar. I really like that. That's powerful.
And you can always have just a little PS at the, I'm like, hey, PS, I've got a masterclass. Yeah. You want to check it out. Like if people are ready, you know, point them in the right direction, but I just think don't go straight, you know, just don't go straight in. Cause it is like the summit, a summit is a lot, like it's great, but they're already, most people struggle to watch all the sessions in a summit. So don't give them extra sessions basically.
Yeah. Yeah, I love that. And I like that you mentioned, you know, set up a different opt-in, but basically like a separate landing page with a little, like a slightly modified funnel to give people a couple weeks of lead in before, you know, maybe you add them to the main funnel, like very practical, simple thing to do, like 30 minutes to get that set up.
Yeah, exactly. And it also helps them with your tracking and things as well, because then you can kind of see, oh, they came through this thing. Like that's, you know, now I know that this worked versus, you know, I'm a big believer. It drives my poor tech VA crazy because I'm like, oh, we're doing a new thing. Duplicate stuff. Like, I want to see what's worked and what
happened. Yep, me too. I love my numbers.
Yeah. My active campaign account is a nightmare, but I like that I can see everything individually.
Oh my gosh, I love it. Okay, so much good stuff today. Thank you so much for sharing all this. If there was like one big takeaway you want people to get from everything, what would you say that is?
I think the main thing is I feel like a lot of people think that a funnel is for later, or that it has to be complicated, or it's this thing that's going to take, you know, or you have to have like a perfect launch before you can have a funnel. Or, and I think it's actually, no, that's the wrong way around. I've seen people who are terrible at launching create really successful funnels. And then the fact that they have this funnel running in the background, they have this little engine, whether it's, you know, making them like one or two extra sales a week, even like it doesn't even have to be anything massive. You don't have to have a Facebook ads budget, but just when they have that thing ticking over that level of certainty, it then, you know, it helps to bring in a bit more budget if you want to invest into a launch, or it helps to take the pressure off when you're doing launches. So it's not like this, you know, boom or bust kind of situation. And I think just taking the time, you know, whether it's 2-3 weeks or whatever it is, have something simple like that set up, keep it simple, don't go crazy, is one of the best investments that you'll ever make in your business. And when, like, the number one thing people say to me when they finally get their funnel set up is, I wish I did this sooner. And so don't put it on the bottom of the to-do list, basically. Just if you have something to sell, you know, you can have a funnel. That's my basically.
No, I love it. I love it. You could always make it more complicated as you go, but it can start out simple and do really incredible things. I got my evergreen funnel up in 48 hours after a live launch. So it doesn't have to take you forever. You can do it and have it start making you money right away. So I love that. That's your takeaway. Oh my gosh. Where can people go to learn more about you and what you offer and all about this incredibly powerful summit strategy information you have?
So katemckibbon.com for now, although if we change the name of the site, it'll redirect. So it's all fine. So I teach sort of like a 4-step process for setting up funnels, and I have a free masterclass on the website, which you can go and check out if you want to find out sort of what pieces are involved in setting up like your first simple but super effective funnel.
I love it. Thank you so much for coming and sharing so freely. I really loved having you here.
It was so much fun. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much for tuning into this episode. For show notes and resources we mentioned, head to summithosthangout.com/075, and the link to Kate's masterclass will be in there as well. So definitely go check it out. In the next episode, we're kicking off a new series going over what to expect during your live event from the time you open it up for registration until the time it's over. So be sure to tune in for that. Now go out and take action to plan, strategize, and launch your profitable online summit.